Hey, welcome to the second video about Java modularity. In the previous video, we talked about the class path concept, which is the fundamental thing how modularity in Java is realized traditionally. We have seen where we find this concept when we use the basic Java tools like the Java compiler, Java C, and the Java runtime, the Java command. And we've explored where we find the things in Gradle, basically the Java compile and the Java exec task, which wrap the Java tools and provide the class paths through different means. What we saw there is that we usually have multiple class paths, at least one for compilation, the compile class path, and one for running the application, the runtime class path. In a real project that is growing, we usually split up our own software into components. In Gradle, this can be done, for instance, in Gradle subprojects. Once we do that, we have even more class paths, because each component has their own ones. In this video, we'll look at that. Let's go back to the example we have used in the previous video. There, we built up a simple project consisting of only one component. Instead of using the Java library or the application plugin, which you would do in a real Java project, we registered the Java compile and the Java exec task to run the application directly. We did this to explore how the class path comes into play in Gradle and how it compares to calling Java tools directly on the command line. We have also created configurations to use Gradle's dependency management to retrieve external dependencies, like SLF4j in this example, from a repository like Maven Central. If you use one of the Java plugins, it would also do the setup for you. But today, I'd like to continue to use the setup to demonstrate how things work when you have multiple components. In Gradle, a software component under development is typically represented by a subproject. In the settings file, we can declare which subprojects we want to have. So in our example, we would like to have an app subproject and a module subproject, where eventually we want to put certain functionality into the module that we can then use in our app. Once we declare these subprojects, we can create two folders with the same names. Now we move our example application source code and the build file we created last time into the app subproject. In the module subproject, we also create a build Gradle KTS file. So now we have two components, each with their own build file. Since our module should also contain Java code that we want to compile, we copy the setup for the compilation, so the compile task and the configurations we need to declare dependencies for compilation, into the build file of the module project. And then we add a Java class, let's call it module A, to have some source code to work with. So now we have two components defined as Gradle subprojects in one Gradle build. Note that these components are completely independent. Each of these components can, for instance, be compiled independently. We see that if we do it with Gradle, that only the compile task runs for the component we target for compilation. Because these components are completely independent, they could also be defined in separate Gradle builds or even live in different source repositories. And this means that both have their own compile class paths. For instance, in the module, I can't just use SLF4j, because it's not on the compile class path. I haven't declared a dependency to SLF4j in the build file of the module subproject. The Java compile task for the module doesn't know about it on its class path. While in the app project, we have declared a dependency, and thus it's on the compile class path of the compile Java task in that project. Now, we would like to have dependencies between our components. Typically, if you develop one software product, you want to integrate all your components into one product in the end. And that's also typically the reason why you have all your components in one repository and define them as subprojects of one Gradle build. In our example, we would like to use the module A class from our module called module in the code of our application module. So as we have learned to make some code available at compile time, we need to put it on the class path of the Java compiler, or in Gradle terms, on the class path of the Java compile task. So we could add the location of the compiled classes of our module to the class path of the Java compile task for the application. This is similar to what you would do if you would compile all these step by step using the Java C tool directly. But in Gradle, we have dependency management, which we already used to help us to retrieve dependencies from repositories. What the dependency management also can do is to build components on demand when we need them. So in case of our module, instead of referencing the classes folder with the compiled classes directly, we can declare a dependency to the module. This is because it's a local project and we always want Gradle to build the current source version that's available locally, so we don't need to define a version. Once this dependency is defined, when Gradle builds the compile class path for the compile task, it'll attempt to get a result from our module project to put on the compile class path. If we run the app project compilation now, we get an error because we haven't told yet what the module project is exporting to be used on the class path of other projects. If we would use the Java library plugin, Gradle would do the setup for us. But since we haven't done that to better understand what's going on behind it, we have to do something now ourselves. Telling what a project exports is also done through dependency management, so through the configuration concept. So what we do now is creating an additional configuration, a so-called consumable configuration, that tells Gradle what the project exports. Let's call it API elements, which corresponds to what the Java plugin is doing. To this configuration, we can now attach artifacts that are produced in this build. For instance, we can say that the output folder of the compiled Java task should be exported to be seen by other projects. Then we need to specify one or multiple attributes. This is because a project can export multiple things. For example, it can export the class folder like we do now. It could also export a jar file in addition, or the Java doc, or test coverage data, or the source code itself. To distinguish between these different exports or views on the project, also called variants in some places in Gradle, we use the attributes. I explain this in more detail in my video about aggregating custom artifacts. The most important attribute that also the Java plugin would use is the usage attribute, which we set here to Java API. Now with this, our module project exports our compiled code as Java API. And now we can go back to our app project. We want to consume what the module project produces. And we can say for the compile class path, we want the Java API of that project, because that's what we compile against, the API that project provides. And if we run the compilation of the app project now, Gradle is able to make the connection between these two projects through the dependency. And as we see here, it also runs the compilation of the code in the module project before, because it knows we want to build against the API of that project, which is represented by the classes folder, which is produced by the Java compile task, and hence it needs to run the Java compile task of that project. Of course, the task could be up to date or from cache, which means it's not really run, but a previous result is reused. In any case, Gradle makes sure that the classes folder is there and is in the latest state. So we don't have to keep care of running the compilations of our separate modules separately. We can just run the compilation of the module or the application we are interested in, and Gradle automatically knows which other code it possibly needs to compile, because there's a dependency on it. If we add a little extra code snippet here for the compile task to print us the class path, we can see that the compile class path of the app project consists of the external dependency we declared, SLF4J API, which is located in the Gradle cache, and the classes folder that is produced by the compile task in our module project. If we do the same for the module project, we can see that there the compile class path is empty, because we don't have any dependencies declared here yet. So we can see that there are differences between the compile class paths. Also, in the end, we build one application. This is the advantage that we can keep components isolated as much as needed during development. So in the code of our module project, we don't see the dependencies of the app project automatically. And if we write code, we can't use types from there, which might be desired to not get everything tangled together. So having these reduced compile class paths in all your components helps you to enforce a certain structure or architecture for your software. Now, what happens if our dependencies have again dependencies themselves, which is also called transitive dependencies sometimes? Let's look at this. Assume In our module, we now want to implement something and need some utility libraries. For example, Commons.io to do some file operations. We add this as dependency, and then we can use types in our code from this external dependency. If we now run the compilation, let's run it directly for our app so it compiles everything, the compilation still works. And if we look at the compile class path for the app project, we can see that Commons.io is not on it, and the compilation still worked, because we only used it internally in the module component. So it's an internal implementation detail, an implementation dependency. Java is able to compile against the code without seeing all the transitive dependencies of that code, because it only needs the public API at compilation time. This is great, but if we now attempt to run our application, we get a runtime exception that the classes of Commons.io are not found. This is very important. At runtime, usually you want all the classes to be available, because otherwise parts of your code, parts of your software are missing. So if you remember, for compile class path, we said that we want the Java API of other projects, which is, as we have seen, a reduced set of all the possible dependencies and jars that project might bring. In our case, Commons.io is not part of this API. So similarly, we could say for the runtime class path that we want the Java runtime of the other project, which should include everything needed at runtime. So we do that, and then in our module project, so the other project, we also need to make this runtime view of the project available. Again, we only need to do that because we don't use the Java library plugin here as you would do in a real project. So what would the Java library plugin do? Similar to how we added the API elements configuration for an API or compile time view, we add a runtime elements configuration for a runtime view. We distinguish both of them by saying this is not a Java API, but a Java runtime. And then in addition to just providing our own artifact here, the result of our compilation, we say that this configuration extends the implementation and the runtime only configuration. So basically saying it contains all the dependencies we define. And now when we run the application in our app project, it works because Gradle now selects the runtime view of other components when it resolves the runtime class path. This not only works for our local project, but also for external dependencies from repositories. Because in addition to the jar, the repositories also contain metadata that contains this information about additional dependencies, which have a scope telling Gradle if something is only needed at runtime or also at compile time. We have seen that we can effectively hide dependencies that are implementation details of a component to other components by not putting it on the compile class path of the other components anymore. Gradle is doing all of this for us when we use dependency management and declare dependencies using different scopes, which are realized through configurations in Gradle. We've seen implementation or runtime only so far. I would always recommend to hide as much as possible during compilation time. It not only makes for better structure and isolation of your components, but may also bring performance improvements in very large builds where a large compile class path can slow down compilation. Still, there might be situations where you want or need to make a transitive dependency visible during compilation time. Let's look at an example. To our module, we add an additional dependency, the JavaX Activation API. This library brings the MimeTime class from which we want to extend. If we run the compilation of our app project code now again, we get an error by the Java compiler that it can't see the MimeType class. This is expected because we only put the classes folder of our module project on the compile class path through the dependency to the module project, but we never added the JavaX activation dependency to the compile class path of the app project. However, in this case, the compiler suddenly needs to see this class because it's part of the type hierarchy of a class we are compiling. And in this case, the compiler needs to know the superclasses. So although we don't use MimeType in any way directly in our app code, it is required for compilation. In other words, by extending from the MimeType class in the code of our module, we made MimeType part of the public API of the module. That means compiler calls that have our module classes on the class path most likely also need the classes from JavaX activation because we extended one of them. We could fix this by adding the JavaX activation dependency also as an implementation dependency to the app project, which could be an acceptable fix, but it's not very nice because we don't use anything from this library directly in our application code. It's only needed for technical reasons if you want by how Java compilation works. So it would be cleaner to fix this in the module so that the consumer of the module, our app, doesn't need to care about that some of the transitive dependencies need to be visible at compilation time. To do something like this, we need to distinguish between dependencies that are implementation details and dependencies that are part of our public API. To distinguish such things, we have different dependency scopes realized through different configurations. We already defined implementation at runtime only. Now we add a third scope, which we call API, as the Java library plugin would do as well. We put all dependencies defined in this new scope not only on the runtime view of our project, but also on the compile time, the API view of our project, by extending from it in the API elements configuration. And then we make the dependency to JavaX activation an API dependency, promoting it from being an implementation detail to being part of the public API of our module. And now our application code compiles again, and we see that JavaX activation is now also part of the compile class path. Note that because it is part of the compile class path, we could just use classes from JavaX activation now directly in our application code, which is, in a way, an undesirable side effect of this, because the Java compiler doesn't care in the end why a certain thing is on the class path. Maybe we don't want to use these classes here directly, at least not without declaring a dependency to JavaX activation directly. So in a clean dependency setup, if you now want to use classes from JavaX activation in application, you should as well add an implementation dependency. Also, technically, for the compiler, it doesn't make a difference. You see that even with only two components in our example project, it's getting challenging to keep an overview, especially when the software evolves and dependencies change over time. It's sometimes hard to see if the right scopes are used everywhere or if certain dependencies are still used at all. Also, certain dependencies might be incompatible and you might have certain conflicts on your class path. Gradle Core offers some functionality to help you with this, for example, by resolving dependency version conflicts. And there are a number of additional plugins that you can use. In the next videos, we'll look at these topics and tools that help you to keep your class paths clean, even in large projects over time. Please subscribe to this channel so you won't miss these, which will contain practical tips that you can use directly in your Java projects.